Welcome to Virginia Leading Ladies, a program exploring paths to success for Virginia young women. Join me, Madeline LaMura, as I engage in discussions with civic, business, and political leaders. Hi, I'm Madeline LaMura. Welcome to this edition of Virginia Leading Ladies. Today, my guest is Vivian Watts, member of the Virginia House of Delegates. Welcome, Delegate Watts. I'm glad
Thank you very much, Madeline.
I'd like to ask you some questions and get some advice that you could share with us. Mm-hmm. What college did you attend?
The University of Michigan.
And why did you choose there?
Well, I was a native of Michigan, and it is definitely the premier university in Michigan. And fortunately, I also got a full tuition scholarship.
Very nice. What did you study at Michigan?
I started out to major in math and psychology, which is an interesting combination. I had about 30 hours of each of those fields, stopping math at the point where you're proving if lines did meet at infinity, how would that change our number system? If it was a sphere or a line or a point, deciding that theoretical math was beyond what I needed, but that has made such a difference in just my innate ability to understand a lot of challenging public policy issues, being very comfortable in working the numbers and looking behind the claims and statistics. In psychology, after 30 hours and a few too many studies about depth perception in chickens, that was not exactly what I had focused on. Had a strong background, however, in physiology, how the brain works, the chemistry of our nervous system and our brain functioning, which has been absolutely invaluable in dealing with drug and alcohol abuse, post-traumatic stress disorder, Alzheimer's, a number of learning disabilities. What I ended up majoring in was English. A good novel is the kind of human experience that was really what my focus was originally going for the degree in psychology.
And did these majors prepare you for your career?
Absolutely. As I've already mentioned, the criticality of not being afraid of numbers, of being willing to go in and look at the data, the psychology, the physiology has, as I mentioned, been invaluable in so many areas, but English as well. Particularly, you have to be able to, even though I'm a numbers person at heart, love the computer, a nerd at heart, being able to be articulate, to be able to get across an idea, to understand, if I can quickly, Madeline, two bookends on English. One, I had non-Latin grammar as one of those courses.
Wow.
And basically what you were focused on is, as it was said, if form gets in the way of substance, you've got to be able to change the form. So to communicate on the street is one form of grammar. To communicate in the courtroom is another form of grammar. Certainly, as I'm out talking to citizens, understanding the way in which you approach how you're presenting your arguments and how you're structuring your arguments. But also, if I could, the other bookend, I went to a rural school through the eighth grade. I had the same teacher, sixth, seventh, and eighth grades. She taught all the subjects. She really did not know anything about math, which was helpful to me because then I was engaged in explaining to other students about how I had gotten the answer to the problem. But more importantly, actually, every day for 3 years, I diagram sentences. And learning the structure of the classic Latin grammar has been invaluable as I serve on the Courts of Justice Committee working with criminal laws where the sentence may go on for 20 lines and understanding how that sentence really defines what the offense is has been important.
And what was your first job, and what responsibilities did that entail?
Well, Madeline, again, I'm two generations removed. I've been so fortunate to live two lives. When I came out of college, I was married, and I'm still married to the same guy. And actually, back in those days, it was wonderful that we had been college students together, because he really respected me, not just as wife and mother, but also, obviously, someone who really enjoys intellectual challenges. So that in leading two lives, as I came out of college, and I very much wanted to be a stay-at-home mom, again, psychology, understanding how important nurturing is. So doors also were not open to women at all. So I did not have my first paid position until after almost 15 years of a lot of volunteer citizen work, heavily on budget, on funding public education, funding family services, what our tax base was, and working with the tax base. My first employer was the Fairfax County Chamber of Commerce because of the work I had done on the importance of the business tax base. And since then, I've held a number of research positions major government accounting firms, but also for 7 years now back, I was the director of a nonprofit, the CASA programs that worked with the most severe cases of child abuse, neglect, which again leads to my understanding of the post-traumatic stress disorder, both for children who've experienced this, but also now with serious veterans issues. I was also Secretary of Transportation and Public Safety. Back in a time, the first secretary, I was dealing with prisons as well as pavements. Almost all my 14 agencies were headed by males, and it was definitely a male's world, but it was a wonderful working relationship for those 4 years.
You were a major voice in getting the big transportation bill passed last year. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Well, there, again, I really did, as you've already perhaps picked up on, I didn't intend for transportation funding to be my life's work.
Yes.
As Secretary of Transportation back in the late 80s, 1986 to 90, I was the secretary when the last time that we increased funding for transportation almost 30 years ago, 28 years ago. And I saw all of the red flags starting more than a dozen years ago of how inadequate our funding was. This has to be an ongoing investment in the critical infrastructure, both for economic development as well as the citizenry's safety and saving time and money in commuting patterns. But unfortunately, the politics were quite different. I was gratified last year that all of my work of the last decade plus to get attention back on this issue had credibility, that people, because I'd been an honest broker on the issue over the years, even though I'm in the minority party, the doors were open to me, and a very good dialogue about responsibly shaping the bill and building on work that I had done.
And what advice would you have for young ladies today?
I guess my first, I don't know what my advice is. Let me start on again with bookends. First of all, I think there really is only one. Bloom where you are planted. Take advantage and fully engage in whatever opportunity presents itself. And in doing that, it has allowed me for one building block after another, and certainly in public policy, there's a tremendous interrelation. You know, mental health is not isolated. Veterans Affairs is not isolated. They all come back to what might be thought to be women's concerns of family health and so on, but in fact are broadly integrated within our general economy and both in the jobs that may be available, the workforce preparation, but most importantly, you can't fund some of these human needs unless you have the kind of financial structure that you need in our economy. So it's all weaved together.
Well, thank you so much, Delegate Watts. I really appreciate your advice and for coming out today.
I really, really enjoyed this. Thank you, Madeline.
Thank you. And thank you for watching this edition of Virginia Leading Ladies.